Welcome back to the channel, everyone. This is Michael yet again, and today I feel like I have sort of a unique video in store for you, especially if you're fans of the late, great Richard Pryor, which I am. Absolutely adore the guy. Always have. Anyway, my good buddy on YouTube here, Matt Ramble Raff for Life, actually donated to the channel and asked me to give my thoughts on the filmography of Richard Pryor. And actually, this is something that I always thought about doing, but it seemed like such a big undertaking that I didn't really quite know how to approach it. And Matt realized that too, because he said, well, you know, I understand it's going to be like a lot of films to talk about, but maybe if you could just give a quick overview about the films and maybe just give your feelings on the movies. And I thought, yeah, that could work. That could most definitely work. So I decided that I would do that. And Matt generously donated to the channel, and every donation is much appreciated. But I thought before I would get to Pryor's films, at least, you know, I'm going to basically just look on the computer and run through his filmography. I actually have some of the films in my personal collection that have Richard Pryor in them. These are films featuring Pryor, and these are not all the films that I have of Pryor. I tried to search for them all, but I'm missing, I don't know, maybe four or six movies that I couldn't find. And my collection is really just spread out. You know, I have movies up in storage, I have movies downstairs, movies under the bed. I quite literally running out of space for movies, guys. But anyway, I just wanted to show these off really fast. And I've kind of, you know, I collect films, and it's always been my goal to specify just one certain actor or series of films and collect those films, because if I start collecting this franchise, that franchise, this actor, that actress, I'm never going to get anything accomplished. But it's really hard to stay away from collecting like that, because what you do is you'll go somewhere and you'll see a movie that you need for one of your collections and you'll get it. So it's really hard to stick on one path. But Pryor's one that I've done quite a bit of collecting for. One day I would love to have all his films. And many of his films have not been released to Blu-ray, which is a shame, but we all know how that is. But at any rate, I'm just going to go through these films real quick. Some of these you've probably never heard of. Because, you know, in researching his films, I bought films that I have never heard of that he was in. This first one, and the first ones are on Blu-ray, actually, and then I go to DVD. Most of his films are on DVD, most of them. Some Call It Loving. And like I said, guys, this is just a blind buy. Richard Pryor in this movie, one of his earlier roles. I don't know in what capacity or so on and so forth. But it's a film that, you know, I wanted to have because it had Pryor in it. Then we have one of his stand-up films, which I've never seen this one. It's called Richard Pryor Omit the Logic. And it looks like vintage Pryor. That's all I can say, man. There's the back of it. Pryor being Pryor. All right. Now we're getting into the movies that people know about. And these are in release order. But this one is Silver Streak. And everybody's heard of Silver Streak because it's like one of Richard Pryor's all-time most famous films. His teaming with Gene Wilder, which, you know, these two guys are just comedy gold together. Next, another Pryor and Gene Wilder team up, Stir Crazy. Again, one of their most famous films together and one of Richard Pryor's most well-known films. Then we have a triple feature of films. This one contains See No Evil, Stir Crazy, and The Toy. And, yeah. Most of these haven't even been opened yet because I'm saving them for future reviews. Now we have DVD, and the first two are two of his stand-up movies. I've seen these, but it's been a long time ago. But this is, Richard Pryor's just great at stand-up, by the way. Richard Pryor, Here and Now. And then we have probably the most famous of them all, or one of the most famous, Richard Pryor Live on the Sunset Strip. I actually went to the theater and saw this one. It's pretty good. All right, one of Richard Pryor's earlier roles in a movie that I've never seen. This is The Busybody. And many of you probably would have never even heard of this movie. It's the first time I'd ever heard of it. Okay. Car Wash. And yes, that is George Carlin there. These two together. Although Pryor's role in this film is really more or less just a glorified cameo. Then we have a four film favorites with Pryor in Greased Lightning, Moving, The Mac, and Uptown Saturday Night. And these movies are all pretty good in my opinion. I enjoyed them. Then again, I have this on Blu-ray, but at the time I bought this on DVD first. Which Way Is Up? And Pryor actually plays three roles in this. He plays, you know, the lead character, then he plays a preacher, and then he plays an old man. I think the old man's his grandfather, but I'm not for sure. It's been a long time since I've seen it. Blue Collar. Most certainly an underrated, underknown Richard Pryor gem. And I won't say too much about the films until I go down the filmography. Another underrated one, Busting Loose, which is a movie that I did enjoy. For a while there, Richard Pryor got quite a few starring roles in lesser known films. Some Kind of Hero with Margot Kidder. Another, in my opinion, another underrated Richard Pryor movie. All right. The Toy, Jackie Gleason. Brewster's Millions. Then we have Critical Condition. And finally, one that I have never seen, and I'll talk more about this when we go over the films, but this is Another You. And this is also Richard Pryor's last film, at least to my knowledge. All right. That's just a little bit of my personal collection. Like I said, I have a few more Richard Pryor films scattered somewhere that I couldn't find. But we're going to get to his filmography, and I'm just going to give just a little insight on the movies that I am aware of. But I'm going to go over all the movies that are listed anyway. Okay, everybody, here I am. First of all, let me apologize for the sounds of my chair. This chair is just always making noise. And secondly, let me apologize for the cars. You know, I live right by a highway, and there's constant cars going up and down the highway. And it really, you know, I really used to lament on the fact of all this noise because, you know, the noise just kind of, I don't know, kind of gets on my nerves. Maybe it's not a big deal to some people, but it does get on my nerve. But anyway, I went over to a friend's house who lives by an Air Force base, and I got to freaking tell you, every 15, 30 minutes, a jet's flying over, and it is so loud. And I was just thinking, I could never make videos at this guy's house. If I lived there, I would literally have to move to make a video. All right. I figure I'd just crack open the Old Glory because we're going to be here for a minute. All right. Starting at 1967, we have Richard Pryor in a film called The Busybody. And I actually own this film. It is listed as the very first film in Richard Pryor's filmography. And I've never seen it. I do own it. I haven't watched it. I know that he really doesn't have a big part in the film because, like I said, it's his first film. It's one that I literally know nothing about. But it says on the poster of the movie, all this picture has is sex. Gangsters, strippers, a million stolen bucks, three stiffs in a coffin, and some of the other little happenings in life. The Busybody. So I don't know, it sounds interesting. It sounds kind of funny, and it is a comedy, and it was produced by William Castle, and that's a guy that a lot of you probably know about. He's also the man behind probably his most famous film, Rosemary's Baby, but I find this one to be very, very interesting. I'm looking forward to watching it. And next, 1968. And Pryor's career, you know, some of his lesser known films or films that, you know, didn't make a lot of money or wasn't successful or whatever. I mean, since 1967, since he first started, he's been pretty busy throughout. Up until his death, the man was just pretty much busy almost every year. Sometimes two or three films in a year. And before I go any further, the way I discovered Richard Pryor was that I believe I was in, was it high school or middle school? I believe I was in the 10th grade. And I had a friend who was also named Michael. And, well, you know, I take that back in thinking about my first introduction to Richard Pryor, because that's not true. That was actually a time I got caught listening to Richard Pryor by my mother, and I got in a little bit of trouble. But no, it's funny how you remember the traumatic events. The actual discovery of Pryor, there, nothing happened. But, you know, I listening to him, that was a different story. But my brother, my older brother, he and his wife, and I was probably about 13, he and his wife had bought a Richard Pryor album. And I won't say the word, but the name of the album was That Ends Crazy. And he would listen to it at his house. And we loved my brother's wife. She was just like a lot of fun. She used to take us to the movies, take us to amusement parks. She was just a lot of fun. And they bought the album, and they just played it while I was there. That was my first introduction to Richard Pryor. So I learned of Richard Pryor from his stand-up comedy. And that particular album is funny as shit. I remember that album being so much fun. And apparently, I wasn't the only one that heard that album, because when I went to school, lots of kids were talking about that album. And I listened to that album so damn much that I literally learned all the stand-up in that album. I could recite it just like that. And I came a little bit of a, I brought a little bit of attention to myself at school, because it became aware or known that I knew that album, and all the kids would want me to recite that album. And, you know, we would just pile up in a corner in the hallway or wherever, and I would just go and say the album with Pryor's mannerisms and all that stuff, and it would just crack the kids up. I should have been a comedian. I'd probably be a lot richer. But anyway, so yeah, that's how I heard of Richard Pryor, and that's what happened after that. And the incident I was talking about with my friend, Mike, who was my best friend, we had borrowed my brother's album. And I knew that my mother would not let us listen to it, because, I mean, Pryor cursed his ass off in that film. I mean, you heard dick, you heard pussy, you heard every freaking curse word in the human language in 1 hour. But anyway, so I knew my mom wouldn't let us listen to it. So we got the album, and me and my friend thought, well, you know, my mom's at work. We'll just, you know, listen to the album. And it was actually on a record player. It was a big, long-playing record. So, and we had a record player at home, and I thought, well, we'll listen to the album before my mom gets home. So we get in after school with the intent of listening to the album, turn the album on, but don't realize my mom is already home from work. She got off early, and she was in the bathroom. I didn't check the house. So my mom, I see my mom walking towards the living room where the stereo player was, and I immediately turned, she knew we were listening to something, but I turned it down real fast. And she, you know, if you have kids, you've seen that look on your kid's face when you know they're doing something, but you don't know what it is. It's like a fucking deer being in headlights. You're like, hi, Mom. So she said, what are you guys listening to? And I said, just an album. She said, what album? And I said, Richard Pryor. Who? Richard Pryor. Is that guy that's always cursing on albums? And I said, no, he don't curse that much. And she said, well, turn it up. I turned it up, and right when I turned it up, Pryor screams out the word pussy. And I'm like, it's over. We're done. And she kind of just went, yeah, that's what I thought. Listen to that. I can't believe y'all are listening to that. and I turned it off, and that was that. I didn't get punished or anything, but she was disappointed. And if you've been a kid before, or if you had kids or have kids, you know that one of the biggest things is that when your parents are disappointed in you, that sometimes that hurts worse than a whipping. And yeah, I got whippings back in the day, guys. We didn't do this fucking stand in the corner shit. But anyway, yeah, that's Pryor. So I started out my love for Pryor in a big way. All right, moving on. 1968. Pryor was in a film called Wild in the Streets. And I actually bought this movie. I own this movie, but it's one of the movies that I couldn't find. And I'm not familiar with this film at all. And this goes back to me. I'm trying to collect all the Pryor's films. So many of these films I've never seen before. But Wild in the Streets is one that I have never seen. And I'll just have to get back to that one. And I'm not really going to go too deeply into it, guys. Because, you know, this video is probably going to be pretty long as it is. And I don't want to, you know, talk too much about it. And then I'm going to do reviews on these films in the future, too. Alrighty, next we have Uncle Tom's Fairy Tales, which was released in 1969. And this is a very interesting one due to the fact that no copies remain of this film, and it's believed to be lost. Now, what it says on here is Uncle Tom's Fairy Tales is a 1969 American comedy film directed by the then film student Penelope Spheris and starring comedian Richard Pryor. The only known negative of this film was said to have been shredded by Pryor after a disagreement with his wife at the time. Pryor, man, calm down with the wives, man. But anyway, it goes on to say, however, in June 2005, scenes from the film appeared in a retrospective while Pryor was being honored by the Directors Guild of America. In August 2005, Pryor and his wife and attorney, in fact, Jennifer Lee Pryor, filed a lawsuit against Spheris and Pryor's own daughter, Rain. The suit claims that Spheris and Pryor's daughter conspired to take the surviving film from his home sometime in the mid-80s. According to the suit, he contacted Spheris after the tribute. She allegedly revealed she had been giving footage to the Academy Film Archive of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences and intended to give the film to Rain. Pryor died in December 2005, but the suit is still currently pending. So, you know, and I didn't know that. You know, when I looked up Pryor's filmography, all that information wasn't available on this film. Maybe it was a different site, but, you know, I was under the impression that the film had been destroyed and that there were no copies. Now, apparently, Spheris, who was the director of this film, I guess was also Pryor's wife at the time. So they got into an argument over the film. Maybe it was creative problems or something, and Pryor destroyed her copy, but apparently she has another copy. So who knows? Maybe one day we might see this. That sounds like a really interesting movie. I'd really love to see Uncle Tom's Fairy Tales. Interesting. All right, 1970. And like I said, Pryor's busy. He's busy every year. The man is busy. I mean, in 1970 alone, he made two films. 1971, he made three films. 1973, he appeared in four films. So the man is busy as shit. Anyway, going back to 1970, we have Carter's Army, which many of you probably have never heard of that. And I've never heard of that name either. But I know it as Black Brigade. That's how I know it as. So Carter's Army, I'm assuming, is the name of the lead guy in charge of the army. But Black Brigade is the way I know it. And I've heard of that film, but I've never seen it. And I actually own that movie, and that's another one that I could not find. But it says Carter's Army is a 1970 American made-for-television war drama starring a host of prominent African-American film actors, including Richard Pryor, Rosie Grier, Robert Hooks, Billy Dee Williams, and Moses Gunn. The film originally aired as an ABC Movie of the Week on January 27, 1970. The film would be released on DVD under the title Black Brigade. And that description is pretty spot on, because all those African-American actors I've heard of, many of you probably have never heard of those, but Rosie Grier was a huge football player at the time. And I don't mean only just that he was a really popular football player, but he was huge. And he kind of made the switch over to motion pictures. He appeared in quite a few things. Robert Hooks, another prominent actor. One role that I remember him from, and sadly it's probably the only role I can really name that I've seen him in, but he was in Star Trek III. He played the commander of Starfleet. Billy Dee Williams, everybody knows him. And Moses Gunn. Some of you may have not have heard of him, and some of you may not have heard of the television series Good Times, but he was the replacement for James Evans, the dad character on that show, when he was written out of the show. But anyway, yeah, Black Brigade, I'd like to give that a shot one day. Okay, that was 1970. Now we have another one in 1970, and I'm not for sure how to pronounce this. It says, it's spelled Phynx. Is that Sphinx? The Sphinx? I've never heard of the Sphinx. I don't own this one at all, but it's definitely like one I'm going to be collecting. I don't own very many of Pryor's earlier films because I just was totally unaware of them. But The Sphinx is a 1970 American comedy film directed by Lee H. Katzin about a rock and roll band named The Sphinx and their mission in foreign affairs. The group is sent to the country of Albania to locate celebrity hostages taken prisoner by communists. Wow. That sounds very, very interesting. And I'm not seeing Pryor listed in the credits, so it must have been a pretty minor role. Let's see, principal cast. I still don't see Pryor. Oh, okay, Pryor was in this as, where is he? Okay, he's listed in this as doing a cameo, so he's probably not in it very much, but he appeared in it. All right, let's see what else we have here. All right, guys, moving on. 1971, as I said, three films. First one is You've Got to Walk It Like You Talk It or You'll Lose That Beat. And it says Richard Pryor played a wino. I've never heard of this one. Says that it's a comedy drama directed by Peter Locke. And like I said, never heard of it. Never heard of Peter Locke. I'm looking at his films, and none of his films I've ever heard of either. But anyway, that's one I have to pick up. And that's assuming that it's been released. You know, it's quite possible that some of these films might not have a home video release. Next, in 1971, we have Live and Smoking. And that's one of Richard Pryor's stand-up performances. I've never seen that one, but I have heard of that one. All right. One of his concert films. Then also, and finally, in 1971, he did a film called Dynamite Chicken. And I've never heard of that one. Dynamite Chicken is a 1971 American comedy film starring Richard Pryor. The film was partly funded by and features John Lennon and Yoko Ono. It is a collection of subversive comedy sketches and routines related to the peace movement. Most famous figures appear as themselves in the film, including Joan Baez, Lenny Bruce, Leonard Cohen, Thule Kuppenberg, Ellen Ginsberg, Jimi Hendrix, B.B. King, Malcolm X, Andy Warhol, Al Capp, Muddy Waters, Sha Na Na, and Al Goldstein. But that's one I have definitely never heard of, and it's one that I'm really fascinated by Pryor's earlier films and appearances. Those are the ones that I'd really like to see because, you know, I mean, before he really hit mainstream, his earlier performances, you just don't really see much support behind them, and I can only assume that's because of the production companies that own these films. Maybe they're just not big, like, you know, when Pryor moved on and started working for the big studios like Warner Brothers and Paramount and companies like that. But these earlier ones, you just never see them. I'm just wondering, does this have a home video release? You know, usually Wikipedia will say if a film was released to home video or has ever been released, and this one's not even listed in it, so I'm assuming that it's not even available. All right, moving on to 1972, a famous film. I wouldn't say it's famous for Pryor being in it, but it's a famous film nonetheless. Lady Sings the Blues. And I believe this was a... I've seen parts of this film, and I know that it stars Diana Ross and Billy Dee Williams. At least I believe, yes. And it also has James T. Callahan, Scatman Carruthers, and of course, Richard Pryor. But I don't remember the role Richard Pryor had in this. And if I think about it, it seems like from the clips I've seen and what I remember, it seems like Pryor was a, yeah, he played the piano in this movie. He was a musician in this film. That's right. All right. Pretty well-known film, at least to a lot of African-Americans. This actually was a favorite film of a lot of African-Americans. Next, we have one called The Mac, and this is from 1973. And this is another film that I own that I couldn't find, so that tells me that these films are together somewhere. And I've seen this film. It's kind of like Blaxploitation. It has that feel about it. And it's a film that I liked, Blaxploitation. I enjoyed this movie. It's once again one of Pryor's earlier films. And I just feel like Pryor, you know, in his earlier films, up into the 80s, he just had this energy about him. He just had this sharpness about him that, you know, in his later films, when he started kind of changing roles where he wasn't so cruel or mean or wasn't so witty, I believe he lost his edge. He was just really sharp back in the day. And this happens to a lot of comedians, you know. It's when their lives change and maybe they have kids and they don't want to come off as, you know, just pompous or arrogant or just an ass. They want to kind of tone it down for the kids and stuff. And they really lose something when that happens. And I think that's why Pryor kind of suffered. And his films were often really mixed when he changed. But The Mac is a 1973 American blaxploitation film directed by California native Michael Campos. Though the reviews were less than favorable upon release, The Mac is considered by many critics to be the best entry in the genre. The film is often categorized as blaxploitation, but Michael Campos and others involved in its production have argued that the general label oversimplifies the film. This was a really decent movie. I mean, I enjoyed it. I would say that it's probably one of Pryor's most underrated films. At least it would be in that category because it's not a bad film at all. I enjoyed this one. And, well, I won't go into it too much, but because eventually I'll do a review of it. But here's an interesting fact about this movie. The film was screened in theaters in only about 20 mostly black communities. Distributors avoided theaters in predominantly white neighborhoods due to the belief that the film would do better in black areas. Despite its low distribution, director Michael Campos has noted that the film outgrossed The Godfather in the cities in which it played. So that's really, really interesting about this movie. All right. Next, 1973, and if you guys remember, I said Pryor made 4 appearances that year. The second one in 1973 is Some Call It Loving. And I actually showed that film in my collection. Never seen it. Don't really know much about it. Some Call It Loving, also known as Sleeping Beauty, is a 1973 romantic mystery erotic drama film. Wow. Written, produced, and directed by James B. Harris. And Richard Pryor is listed as 4th in appearing in the film. It is based on a short story by John Collier. I don't know anything about this film, but Sleeping Beauty, that sounds interesting. See if there's any interesting stories right quick before I move on. American reviewers tended to dismiss the film as rambling, contemporary fable that is merely pretentious. So it wasn't reviewed very well. Stars Zalman King. Who is Zalman King? I've never seen... Ah, that's Zalman King. He died in 2012 at age 70. He doesn't look familiar to me. What has he appeared in? Has he appeared in anything that I've seen?
No, he hasn't appeared in anything I've seen. He was in an episode of Charlie's Angels in Land of the Giants, but I wouldn't remember those. All right. Third film from 1973 is one called Hit. And I have never heard of that film, Hit. I'm looking at the poster. I'm going to assume by that name it's about a hitman. Hit is a 1973 action film directed by Sidney J. Fury and starring Billy Dee Williams and Richard Pryor. It is about a federal agent trying to destroy a drug zone after his daughter dies from a heroin overdose. Wow, that sounds really interesting. Sounds interesting. This is one that, you know, I would like to give a watch. Has it been released on home video? It's not telling. So maybe some of these have been released and it's just not listening. And I want to see if it's been released right quick. Boys and girls, give me just a moment. I'm looking on Amazon. Hit Richard Pryor. Because this is one that I wouldn't mind giving a watch. And no, it doesn't look like it has a home video release. This is bullshit. Why don't these films have home video releases? Another name is Goodbye Marcellus, which is an alternate title for the movie. Let's see if it's listed under that. Nope. So apparently that film is unavailable. Oh well. You know, with a big star like Billy Dee Williams and Richard Pryor, it's amazing to me that some of Richard Pryor's films haven't been released to home video. That's fucking pathetic. Who put this out? And it's fucking Paramount Pictures. Oh wait. It says that there was indeed a home video release of the film in 2012. Well, why isn't Amazon bringing that up? Usually when a film isn't even available, you can still see it on their list. Let's see if it's... I'm going to put in Olive Films. Oh, I did that wrong. Now let's try it. Please forgive Optimus Prime, who just drove by. It's not listing it at all. Now, sometimes when it's hard to find a film on Amazon, you can check eBay. Chances are you might be able to find it there, or you might be able to find a bootleg copy of it. Let's see if it's on eBay. No, not under that name. When I type in Hit, it just keeps bringing up his stand-up. Let's try Olive Films. And nope, not even on eBay. Does Olive Films, and I'm getting sidetracked, guys, but forgive me. Does Olive Films have a website? Maybe you can get it on their website. Olivefilms.com. Yeah, there we go. The site's still available. All right, they've got a search bar. Let's see if Hit's up there. If it's not on their own site and they made the DVD, something's up. Waiting for Olive Films. All right. I don't have all day, Olive Films. We are currently updating our store and inventory management systems and we'll be ready to accept orders again in early August. And I am not seeing it from the search. Let's search Richard Pryor. Maybe that'll bring it up. Don't you just hate like when you're typing shit and you're looking at the keyboard? What the fuck are you doing here, computer? I didn't even finish typing and they went to something. But what I was gonna say, don't you just hate when you're looking at the keyboard typing something and then you look up and you haven't typed shit? Okay, there we go. Richard A-R-D-B-R-Y-O-R. And yeah, there's Hit. Yep, they do indeed have it. It says $22.99, and it looks fucking cool-ass cover with Richard Pryor, Paul Hampton, and Gwen Weller. I'm going to have to pick it up, everybody. Going to have to pick it up. Alrighty. Going back, that was 1973. And finally, the last film in 1973 is one called Wattstack. Wattstack. Never heard of that. Oh, okay. So, instead of Woodstock, we have Wattstack. It says it's a benefit concert organized by the Stack Records to commemorate the 7th anniversary of the 1965 riots in the African-American community of Watts, Los Angeles. Okay. So that's more or less kind of a documentary film. Says it won Best Documentary Film of 1974. And I guess Richard Pryor appeared in it. He's listed as second star. What did he do in that, I wonder? Is it going to list it on here? Wow, this had quite a few people in it. Even had Mario Van Peebles in it. The Staple Singers. Looking for Pryor. And I don't see him. Maybe if I go down here. No. Well, we know he was in it. And if it's Pryor, I'm sure he performed a comedy routine. All right, leaving 1973 for 1974, where Pryor only appeared in one film, and that film was Uptown Saturday Night. And that's another film I own in Pryor's collection. And I know I have it on, like, maybe a three-film or a four-film collection, but I also have a standalone film of it, too. And Uptown Saturday Night, I remember watching that as a kid. And it's a comedy film where you have two cops, one played by Sidney Poitier and the other by Bill Cosby. And they did like maybe two sequels, or this might even be the sequel film, but I don't remember. But the films were really good. The films were really funny. I really enjoyed these films. Sidney Poitier and Bill Cosby had some really good chemistry in that movie. And it's a gem. It's most certainly a gem. But I enjoyed Uptown Saturday Night. But and Richard Pryor was really good in it too. Let's see. Under supporting cast, it says Richard Pryor as Sharp Eye Washington. Alrighty. And that film was indeed a hit when it came out. It was a small hit, but it was a hit. Next, 1974, we had Uptown Saturday Night, but Pryor didn't make another film until 1976. So he actually did take a break for a year. Probably was tired. Probably wanted to take off for a year. All right. So, in 1976, Pryor caught back up with his schedule as he appeared in four films. And let's see. Two of these films, Silver Streak, he played a pretty big part in. So the other ones, I'm not sure about one of them because I've never heard of it. But beginning in 1976, the first film is called Adios Amigos, or Adios Amigo. And it says Adios Amigo is a 1975 American comedy Western film written and produced by Fred Williamson, who also stars in the lead role. The film co-stars Richard Pryor and James Brown. Wow, that sounds really, really interesting. James Brown? I don't think I've ever seen James Brown in a film. Mega talented James Brown. Got a lot of love for the guy. Just, you know, love James Brown. Does this film have a home video release? That's one I'm going to have to go back into, guys. I'm not going to check right now. But that sounds like a movie that I'd really be interested in seeing. Richard Pryor as a cowboy? Wow. All right. Although he turned down Blazing Saddles. That would have been hilarious, too. Second film in 1976, The Bingo Long Traveling All-Stars and Motor Kings. Now, this was I've seen this film. And I would also say, once again, this is another film that's underrated. I think it's a good film. It's an early film by Richard Pryor. He plays as a part of a African-American baseball team shows their trials and tribulations. But it was a good film. It's a really good film. And it says that it's a 1976 American sports comedy film about a team of enterprising ex-Negro League baseball players in the era of racial segregation. It was a good film. I mean, you had Billy Dee Williams, you had James Earl Jones, of course Richard Pryor, and you had some real talent there, and you had a film with a lot of heart in it. I really enjoyed the Bingo Long Traveling All-Stars and Motor Kings. It was a decent film. The film was a box office success, grossing $33 million on a $9 million budget. So that's a pretty big hit. In 1976, that was a lot of money. So, you know, that was a good film. And it had a lot of really good performances in it. I enjoyed it. I actually own that film, too. Alrighty. Next, 1976, the third film is Car Wash. And this is the one that Richard Pryor does basically a glorified cameo in. He's only in the film, I would say, maybe 3 or 4 minutes. But his appearance is really, really good. He plays a minister in the cameo. But the film itself, Car Wash, is really... Car Wash is a great film. I really enjoyed Car Wash. I remember the first time I saw that, I just thought that film was just so funny. And by the name, it is about the film does take place at a car wash. It shows a day in the life of these workers at a car wash, the funny situations they get in. And if you can get past that 70s, the afros and the clothes and just how everything was back then, I believe there's a lot of fun to be had with this movie. This is one that, I don't know if they ever released this on Blu-ray, but I have a DVD of it, and if they haven't released it on Blu-ray, that's pretty sad. But Car Wash is a good movie. I really enjoyed Car Wash. It says that Car Wash had its network premiere on NBC Monday Night at the Movies in 1978. Along with the standard dubbing of strong language, many scenes that included the gay character Lindy was trimmed or deleted. To replace these shortened scenes and therefore shortened film, a subplot of a diner owner was reinserted. As of 2013, commercially available versions of the film were of the original theatrical release, not the revised TV version. So, that's interesting, because when I saw the film for the very first time, I saw it uncut. So I saw the gay character, and that just kind of goes to show, you know, I know back in 1970s, you know, TV was pretty much, you know, there was really no PC elements around. I mean, you know, comedians like Red Fox would say the N-word on TV, and then, you know, it just wasn't a big deal. And just to show you so how out of touch I was, if there was a gay character in the film, I really paid no attention. Oh, wait, yeah, I remember the gay character. It was played by Antonio Fargas, who played Huggy Bear on Starsky and Hutch. Yeah, he, and for those of you who don't know of Starsky and Hutch, maybe you've seen the film, what was the name? I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker. He played the pimp with the shoes on, with the heels on, that had the fish in the heels. But yeah, he played the gay character in that. So when I saw it, yeah, there was a gay character in the film. And just to show you how out of touch or how I didn't care, I didn't think anything about it. But in the 70s, they cut it. Now, of course, now I guess we could say, you know, everybody complains about being PC today. But this was back in the 70s, and they wouldn't show the gay character when it was on TV. But now they would. So, I mean, some progress has been made in a good way. All right, Car Wash, definitely underrated. A great film. Next and finally in 76, you know, I want to see how much money did Car Wash make? It doesn't say on here. Does not say. But it's got an 88% on Rotten Tomatoes. It's a hilarious movie. Next we have Silver Streak, the final film in 1976. And that's probably a film that many of you know of Richard Pryor being in, because that's one of his most famous movies. And it was also the first film that he and Gene Wilder ever teamed up on. And I like Silver Streak. It was a really good movie. And I believe it was a big hit too. I believe it made lots of money. Cost $5.5 million to make, and it made $51 million. So Pryor was on a roll. I mean, he had done Bingo Long, which was a $33 million gross on just a single digit production cost. Then he made Car Wash, which was a hit. Then he made Silver Streak, which was a hit. And then his next one, in 1977, he appeared in two movies, the first one being Greased Lightning, where he played Wendell Scott, I believe his name was. Greased Lightning is a 1977 American biographical film starring Richard Pryor, Beau Bridges, and Pam Grier. The film is loosely based on its true life story of Wendell Scott, the first African-American NASCAR race driver in 2015 NASCAR Hall of Fame inductee. So yeah, Greased Lightning is one of Pryor's, I would say, underrated performances. It's a film that many probably don't know that he did. And, you know, surprisingly enough, when you think of Richard Pryor, really, mostly you think about comedy and laughs and all that. But, you know, in the beginning, he did appear in comedies, but Richard Pryor also did a lot of dramatic roles. And he was a good dramatic actor. He's not known for those roles, and he's probably underrated in those roles, but he was a good dramatic actor. He had crossed over. He could do both. And I think Greased Lightning is just one of those movies that shows that he could carry a film on a dramatic level. And Greased Lightning was a really good film. Underrated. All right. Moving on. We're still at 1977, and his last film in 1977 was Which Way Is Up? And this is a movie that, God, guys, one of my all-time favorite Richard Pryor films. This is a tremendous film. And this is before Eddie Murphy did The Nutty Professor, where he played so many characters, because Richard Pryor actually played three characters in this film. And what's really hilarious about Richard Pryor playing three characters, you know, the makeup techniques weren't really too sophisticated like they were by the time Eddie Murphy played the clumps. In this movie, you know, if Richard Pryor, he played a minister and an old man. And you know, the way they would do the makeup, and I don't know if they did this on purpose or not, but the makeup was so just cheaply put on, where he's an old man, you can just tell he has a wig on and a little bit of gray. And that added to the whole it's funny bit. But when he's playing the grandfather character, it's just funny as shit. And this is a film that I saw, and I don't remember if I've seen this in the theater or not, but I just thought this film was so funny. It's one of those Richard Pryor movies to me that I could just watch anytime because it's just so fucking funny. But it says, Which Way Is Up is a 1977 American comedy film starring Richard Pryor and directed by Michael Schultz. It is a remake of the 1972 Italian comedy film, The Seduction of Mimi. Richard Pryor plays three roles: an orange picker who has two women at the same time, the orange picker's father, and a reverend who gets the orange picker's wife pregnant. Okay, so the old man wasn't his grandpa, it was another character, but it's a hilarious film. I really enjoyed it. Let's see if this film, it don't tell how much money it made, but yeah, TV Guide, this is what TV Guide, they gave it one star, and they said, Richard Pryor plays his character as unlikable, making the film unfunny. That is so fucking ridiculous. Ridiculous. TV Guide. Who reads fucking TV Guide? Anyway, do they still make TV Guide? Anyway, probably do. Now we're in 1978, and Richard Pryor appeared in three films. The first one being Blue Collar, and that also had Harvey Keitel in it. And that's another film where Pryor took on a dramatic role. And I think he was good in that role. And it says, one of the early reviews from the New York Times says that Richard Pryor has a role that makes use of the wit and fury that distinguishes his straight comedy routines. Pryor was good in the movie. I would say that Pryor is probably one of the best things about the movie. I mean, Harvey Keitel was good. And this movie also had Yaphet Kotto, which, you know, Yaphet Kotto, mostly known for playing Parker from Alien. You don't really see him in a whole lot of stuff. I know that he did things, but I just really don't know a whole lot of what he did. But he was in this film. And like I said, Richard Pryor plays a dramatic role, and I think he did a good job. I think it's an underrated movie. And the movie was a hit, a minor hit. I mean, it cost $1.7 million to make, and it made $6.5 million. But it's a decent film. I mean, this film literally holds a 100% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes. And not that I give a shit about what Rotten Tomatoes says, because most of the time they're rotten. But, I mean, 100%. I'm kind of curious, though, to see what it holds on IMDb. Let's see what IMDb says. IMDb says that it gets a 7.5. But, you know, if you ever get the chance and you're a Pryor fan, give the movie a shot. Now, I didn't really say what it was about, but basically it says a 1978 American crime drama film. That's where I'll leave it. All right. Back at 1978, and a film that I do have but could not find is The Wiz. And this is basically an African-American version of The Wizard of Oz. And I'm not really too fond of musicals. This was a musical. Now, the music was good. But I think I might have seen this in the theater, or I don't really remember. It's been so long ago. I might have caught it on TV. But I don't really remember being impressed by the film. I think I was more impressed by who was in the film, you know, like Michael Jackson, Richard Pryor, Mabel King. I mean, it really, Nipsey Russell. It really had some big stars in it. Diana Ross. But it's just not one of those standout films that I love. I mean, Richard Pryor was decent in the movie. But, you know, when it comes to The Wizard of Oz, the original film is always my favorite. It's not a total waste of time or anything like that, but it's certainly not one of my favorite films. And I do own that movie. Next, and finally in 1978, we have a film called California Suite, and I've never heard of this movie. Alan Alda, Michael Caine, Bill Cosby, Jane Fonda, Walter Matthau, Elaine May, Richard Pryor, and Maggie Smith. The best two-hour vacation in town. I've never heard of this. California Suite is a 1978 American comedy film directed by Herbert Ross. The screenplay by Neil Simon is based on his 1976 play of the same name. Yeah, I've never heard of this. I'm kind of surprised that I've never heard of this. Richard Pryor plays a character called Dr. Chauncey Gump. So I'm assuming he's probably not in this very much. Does it even mention him in the description? I'm looking over the synopsis of the movie, and usually they'll list the character or the actor, but it's not even listing him in the synopsis, so he must not have a very big part in it. Was it successful? Film apparently was a critical hit, 54% on Rotten Tomatoes. Box office of $42 million, so I'm pretty sure it probably didn't cost that much. So it probably was a hit. And it was also nominated at the Academy Awards for Best Supporting Actress, Best Screenplay, Best Art Direction. Wow, sounds like it was a popular film, and I've never heard of this. That's really kind of odd. Yeah, sounds like an interesting movie. Okay, we're on to 1979, where Pryor appeared in two films. The first one being Richard Pryor Live in Concert. And I actually used to have the album version of this stand-up comedy film or concert film, but I don't think I have it anymore. But yeah, that's a concert film. And wow, Pryor was pretty popular by this time and had appeared in quite a few successful films. And the budget on this thing was $750,000, and it went on to gross $15.8 million. That's a huge profit. So wow. And it says Pryor was nominated by the National Society of Film Critics, and he didn't win. He got Best Actor, 5th place, but he was nominated. Alrighty. Finally, in 1979, he did The Muppet Movie, and he played the balloon vendor, and it was a cameo. And I remember seeing him in that cameo in The Muppet Movie. And once again, you know, that was a cameo that he appeared in, and the movie, which cost $8 million, went on to gross $70 million. So that was another hit for Pryor. All right, now we're in the 80s. And the 80s, to me, were kind of like the change for Richard Pryor. That's when his films just became, as an actor, he became a lot softer. He didn't have that kind of devious edge anymore. And that's when I feel like Pryor changed, and he just wasn't as sharp as he used to be. Now, that's not saying that he didn't make some good films. But, you know, the Pryor that we would see that would, you know, cuss and, you know, pretty much just, you didn't know what the man was going to say. Those days were pretty much over. All right, 1980, he appeared in three films. The first one being Holy Moses. And I think that was Mel Brooks, wasn't it? Was that a Mel Brooks film? Let's see, directed by Gary Weiss. No, it wasn't Mel Brooks. I was thinking it was Mel Brooks. I'm thinking of another movie, probably. But Holy Moses, I don't know if I've ever seen this movie. He played the Pharaoh, and I don't remember it, but I do remember hearing that the film wasn't that good and that it performed poorly and that it was a pretty much a waste of Richard Pryor's talent. So I'm looking at it now, and it cost $12 million to make, and it only grossed $14 million, so yeah. The film received poor reviews. Because of a production hiatus imposed on their television show, Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel did not review the film on sneak previews upon its initial release. Lots of history on this film, but yeah, that's one that I don't own, and I've never really seen. Next, 1980, we have In God We Trust. And this is another one that, you know, 1980, I've never heard of this movie, In God We Trust. And it says that Richard Pryor plays the character of God. So I've never heard of this. He's listed as fifth star in this. In God We Trust is a 1980s American comedy film starring Marty Feldman, Andy Kaufman, Louise Lasser, and Peter Boyle. A biting religious satire, it was also produced, directed, and co-written by Marty Feldman. I've never heard of this film, which really isn't a good sign. That might mean it didn't do too well. Doesn't say how much it cost to make it, but it says the box office was $5 million, so it probably didn't cover its production costs. Richard Pryor as God. God, let's see if it's some mention of it in here. He prays to God for guidance and he prays to God for guidance, and it tells him to work with Ambrose to make more money. So apparently God isn't God, it's something else. But let's see. Yeah, they are talking about God. So but they list God as G period O period D period. So not just the word God, but okay, it stands for General Organizational, what? Directivator? General Organizational Directivator is a sophisticated master computer linked to all of Thunderbird's finances and operations. So God is a computer. And Richard Pryor, I guess, is the voice of the computer? Interesting. Sounds interesting. Okay. The last film in 1980 and a big hit for Pryor and one of his most well-known movies is Stir Crazy. And Stir Crazy is probably, well, that's, I started to say it's probably one of my favorite Gene Wilder, or my favorite Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor films, but that's hard to say really. But I liked it better than I liked Silver Streak. So I guess the toss-up would be between Stir Crazy and See No Evil, Hear No Evil. Damn it, Prime, how many times are you going to go in a circle? But anyway, I like Stir Crazy. Stir Crazy was a lot of fun. I think it's a really, really good film. And I believe it was a really big hit, too, when it came out. It says it cost $10 million to make, and it made $101 million. And this is 1980 money, so that's a lot of money. And I'm sure you guys know about this film, most of you anyway. But this is the film where Richard Pryor and Gene Wilder get accused of a crime, and they end up going to prison, and it deals with them in prison. And it's funny shit, man. It's a funny-ass film. And Pryor was kind of like, you know, right in this territory in terms of playing this character. Says they got a 125-year jail sentence. So you can imagine. I remember when the judge gave that sentence, and Pryor's reaction, and it was just, it was hilarious. This is a movie that, you know, just even reading about it kind of makes me want to go back and watch it again. All right. That was 1980. Now we're in 1981, and he only did one film in 1981, and it was a starring role. And this says that, what, he also produced and wrote the story. Wow. The movie is Busting Loose. And I would say Busting Loose is one of those underrated Richard Pryor films. Underrated because of the fact that it's a good film that has a lot of heart in it. And, you know, Pryor plays a convict who's kind of given a second lease on life. And he ends up driving this bus for a school teacher who's taking these kids on a field trip, and the kids are all troubled kids. And Pryor ends up, you know, becoming a better person because of it, and finding a good cause to fight for. So it's a film, it's one of those feel-good films. And I think Pryor, he was really good in it. I think it was a good movie. I enjoyed this movie. It's underrated. This is a film that more people should talk about. But it also has Cicely Tyson in it. And Cicely Tyson is a wonderful actress. Wonderful actress. This film was a hit. $11 million to make. $31.3 million gross. So it was a hit. It was a good film. It's a really good film. Busting Loose opened number one at the box office in 828 theaters domestically. It grossed $6.6 million in its opening weekend. It ended its run with $31 million. Critical response, only the incomparable Richard Pryor could make a comedy as determinedly, aggressively sentimental as Busting Loose, which is about 8 needy orphans and a $15,000 mortgage that's due, and it still gets an R rating. Vulgar language is the reason, but because vulgar language is a basic part of Richard Pryor's comedy method, one longs for his every assault on gentilism in Busting Loose, a film that would otherwise be painful. So Pryor made the movie, man. And we're still dealing with the Pryor that gets an R rating. And that's one thing I missed about Richard Pryor. When he started doing all these family-friendly characters, that edge was just gone. I know I've said that before, guys, but yeah. Okay, 1982. Pryor appeared in 1, 2, 3 films. And I've heard of all three of these films. The first one is Some Kind of Hero. He played Eddie Keller. And this is a 1982 American comedy drama film starring Richard Pryor as a returning Vietnam War veteran having trouble adjusting to civilian life. And I would also say this is another Pryor film that's underrated. And I think he does a good job with the role. And it has moments that are really sentimental. He has a mom who's in a nursing home. And I remember, you know, his mom is, I don't remember exactly what she was suffering from. But she could barely talk, and I seem to remember some kind of memory problems, maybe Alzheimer's or something. But I remember at the end of, I remember maybe he was having trouble paying for her care at the facility. And, you know, I believe he tried to work and so on and so forth, and just things wouldn't just work out. And he ended up, you know, planning a robbery to make ends meet. And I remember one of the high points of this thing for me was at the end when he went to see his mom to tell her that, you know, I can pay for this and you're going to be all right. And that was just really a really nice scene. Okay. But yeah, Some Kind of Hero. I enjoyed it. It was a good movie. It was a really good movie. An underrated film. Even though, you know, it really wasn't a big success at the box office and the critics were mixed on it. But, you know, it was a decent film. I mean, in terms of box office, it didn't make a lot of money, but it did triple its budget. So there you have it. And that's all due to the name power of Richard Pryor. Richard Pryor made a really big name for himself. A lot of people generally love Richard Pryor. And I think a lot of the reason people love Richard Pryor was the fact that the man did not hold his tongue. He said what the fuck he wanted to say. He said what was on his mind, and people love that about him. It's so refreshing when you know how somebody feels versus somebody hiding the shit, you know? Give me somebody telling me that they don't like me versus, hey, Mike, how you doing? Good to see you. And deep down inside, they're thinking, I hate this guy. All right. The next film in 1982, Richard Pryor Live on the Sunset Strip. That was a concert film. They filmed this concert and made it into a film, which is, you know, a cheap way to make some money. So it says that the budget for this was $4.5 million and it went on to gross $36 million. So, you know, I believe this was Columbia Pictures, wasn't it? Yeah, Columbia Pictures. So that was a big hit for them. The highest grossing comedy concert film of all time until surpassed by Eddie Murphy's Raw in 1988. So, you know, it was a big hit for Pryor. And I enjoyed Richard Pryor Live on the Sunset Strip. I would say it's one of his best stand-ups. It was a lot of fun. Natural talent Pryor had for stand-up. Alrighty. The final film in 1982 is one called The Toy, with Richard Pryor and Jackie Gleason. And I actually saw this one at the theater, and I wasn't really too big a fan of this film. I thought that a lot of the humor was lackluster. I thought Richard Pryor was just too reserved. He was held back. He really wasn't the Pryor that we were used to seeing. And wasn't this film PG? You know, I think this was before they got the PG-13 bullshit, but I think it was PG. It's pretty sad that you long for a PG-rated film versus PG-13, which is usually what all films are today. They don't have the rating on this? Really? Really? I'm curious, guys. I believe this was PG. Maybe it's on... Would they list that on IMDb? The Toy. And I don't know. It might be listed on there, but I don't see it anywhere. Let's see if I can look it up. Typing sucks, guys. I put movie rating. It's probably going to pull up the 3 stars or something. I just can't find the rating for the movie, guy. Okay. PG. Yeah, it was PG. So this is one of those films that Pryor kind of started to tone everything down, and he was a different character, kind of playing the nice guy in a bad situation. And I don't know, guys. I thought The Toy had some funny moments, but overall, I just really didn't care too much for The Toy. I just thought this was probably the pivotal role in which Richard Pryor tried to change his image. And I really didn't like the changing of his image. Okay, now we're on to 1983, where Richard Pryor was in 2 films. The first one was Superman 3, which this was really kind of a clash for me. And instead of going in on a full review of the film itself, I'll just say that I love Superman and I love Richard Pryor. But those two definitely don't mix. So I'll leave it at that. Now, this was a high-profile appearance for Richard Pryor being in a Superman film, especially right after Superman 2, which was a big hit and a lot of success. The film grossed over $100 million. And it was a good vehicle for Richard Pryor's career. It didn't hurt him at all. But really, I'll keep it at that until I do a full-on review of the film. Next, in 1983, we have Richard Pryor Here and Now, which was another concert film, I believe. Yes, a 1983 American stand-up comedy concert film starring and directed by Richard Pryor, who also wrote. Of course he wrote it. He's doing the concert material, so why wouldn't he write it? So, yeah, I remembered Here and Now, and I thought here, you know, you can't really go wrong with Richard Pryor's concert films, because inevitably there's moments in there that you're going to laugh your ass off. And that was another funny film put out by Columbia Pictures. There's no information on the how much the film made. Let's see if we can find out. I'm sure it was a hit regardless. Domestic gross $16 million, and you know it didn't cost much to make this concert film, so it was most likely a hit. All right. Then we have, we're moving on to 1985, And Richard Pryor did a film called Brewster's Millions. And like I said, this is another one of those films where Pryor, you know, everything's toned down. The Pryor that we would see that would spew all kinds of curse words and all that was pretty much over. And I think that he really didn't return to his earlier roots until he appeared in, I'm going to say, See No Evil, Hear No Evil. Although there were a few cuss words in Harlem Nights, but overall, you know, that's not the Pryor that we were used to. I would say Pryor didn't become his any hints of his old self until See No Evil, Hear No Evil. But Brewster's Millions, you know, I saw this at the theater, and I enjoyed Brewster's Millions. It's one of those few Pryor films where he was a different kind of character, and I enjoyed him. I thought he was, there was genuinely some funny moments in the film, but I think the part that I liked about the movie was, you know, him and John Candy, I felt like they had good chemistry together. And I think over time, with John Candy's passing and Richard Pryor's passing, it does kind of make these films just a little bit more heartfelt. But, you know, when I first saw this, you know, both these actors was alive, and I enjoyed it. I thought it was a funny film, and I liked the characters. I like John Candy, and I like Richard Pryor. So, Brewster's Millions, I didn't have a problem with it. Now, we're on to 1986, and Pryor had one film, and that's really understandable because he also wrote this film, and he also directed this film, produced it as well. So, it took up a lot of time. And it's a film that I would most certainly say is an underrated movie that a lot of people just do not watch because it's not what they expect from a Richard Pryor movie. But this is a semi-autobiographical film of Pryor's life. And it's Jojo Dancer, Your Life is Calling. And it takes situations and events from Pryor's life and turns it into a movie. And I saw this film in the theater, and I really love this movie. I loved it. It's a really, really fun movie. Not in terms of just laugh out loud. It is a comedy drama, but I enjoyed seeing this look into Pryor's life and knowing that, you know, yeah, this might be a little bit exaggerated, but Pryor's directing this and this really happened. And I enjoyed Jojo Dancer, Your Life's Calling. I think it had some genuinely good dramatic moments in it. It had some tear-jerking moments in it. It had some funny moments in it. And I don't know. This film just, I've just always loved it. And it's just one of those different kind of Pryor films that I guess I could just feel his personal touch on the movie. And it's definitely one of those movies that I feel like is just so underrated and that a lot of people don't know of, never seen. But I enjoyed it. I mean, Richard Pryor's like pizza. Even when it's cold, it's good. So, you know, I think it's just so underrated. Now, this says that Jojo Dancer, Your Life is Calling is a 1986 American biographical comedy drama film directed, produced by and starring Richard Pryor. This was the first and only feature film Pryor directed. Now, let's see. What were the... As Dancer lies hospitalized in a coma, his spiritual alter ego revisits his life. From growing up in a brothel, which Richard Pryor really did, as a child, and struggling to beat the long odds to become a top-rated comedian, which Richard Pryor did. However, this success leads to extensive drug use, which Richard Pryor did, womanizing, did that too, that takes its toll on his life. Jojo's spirit watches and attempts to convince his past self to end this cycle of self-destruction. And you know, reading that kind of reminds me of why I like the film too, because it's like if you're about to do something that is going to have repercussions in your life and you don't know it, and you have yourself, your spiritual self there watching and saying, "Hey man, don't do this, you're going to regret it, don't do it." But you know, we all tend to not listen. And, you know, things go awry. But that's one of the reasons I like the film, too. Let's see. JoJo Dancer, Your Life is Calling received mixed reviews from critics. It currently holds a 55% Rotten Tomatoes rating, and it deserves much more than that, guys. So if you ever get a chance and you're a Pryor fan, check out JoJo Dancer, Your Life is Calling. I own that film too, but I can't find it. I don't even think there's been a Blu-ray release of that movie either. All right. 1987 would see Richard Pryor in critical condition. And I remember this film. I saw this one at the theater. And this film did not receive great reviews at all. A lot of people do not like this movie. It wasn't a big hit. And I liked it, though. I did not have a problem with critical condition. Of course, I haven't seen it since the theater. But at the time, you know, I laughed. I had a fun time with it. I liked Pryor as a character. I had a lot of fun with Critical Condition. So, I don't know. It's going to be really interesting to come back to these movies after all this time and watch them again. But it says, Kevin Lanahan is a con man who is framed in a jewelry robbery to escape custody before he fakes insanity and then poses as a surgeon. Wait. To escape custody before he fakes, that don't sound right. Anyway, he fakes that he is a doctor in a mental institution, and you know, that's where the adventure takes place. But it's a fun movie, I enjoyed it. Let's see what it says here. Yeah, I overall they say it was a disappointing title to Richard Pryor's credits. And I don't agree, guys. I mean, but like I said, I haven't seen it in a long time. The film debuted at number one, so you know Pryor still had the drawing power to move a film up to number one. All right, we're on to. Okay, so that was 1987. JoJo Dancer was 1986. 1988 saw the release of the Pryor film Moving, and Moving. I think my initial reaction to this film when I saw it at the theater was that I just thought it was kind of dull. I don't remember really laughing that much, and I remember maybe being just a little bit disappointed by it, but I haven't seen Moving in so long, so I don't know how I would feel about it today, but I can only remember that back in the day I just didn't really find it very funny. Let's see what critics say. It only made $10 million. Film debuted at number 4 and was a failure at the box office. Yeah, it didn't really do too good at all. Who released this? This is Warner Brothers. So yeah, Moving. It's going to be interesting to return to that one and watch it again. Moving. Next, 1989 would see the release of See No Evil, Hear No Evil. And you have those movies, when you go to the movies, you have those experiences where you just have fun at the movies. And this was a film I saw in the theater, and it was just fun as shit. This was a funny, laugh-out-loud film. I had a great time when I saw this movie. And it's kind of neat, guys. It's kind of neat when you see the title of a movie, and it brings and stirs so many good feelings inside you. And this was one of those films that I just had a fun time. I just laughed so much. It was just a fun movie. And it was a nostalgic movie, seeing Pryor and Gene Wilder together again. And I just recently watched it again per request of my buddy Rambo Raff for Life. And I hadn't seen it in a long time. And it was still just a very funny film. And it was an emotional film now because both actors have passed on. But See No Evil, Hear No Evil, I enjoyed it. I thought it was a good film. I mean, you know, in retrospect, I would say that I wish they did more films, Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor, because together, they could do no wrong, you know? I mean, other than, you know, the last film that they did, but Richard Pryor was in such poor health, you know, that he just couldn't do it. But these guys could do no wrong. I mean, they were just great together. Just really good. I really enjoyed See No Evil, Hear No Evil. And it even returned Pryor to that sharp tongue kind of character that we had just been so used to, and that honestly that we just love so much. And it was nice to see Pryor return back to form. But sadly, you know, that wouldn't happen again. Okay, so I was wrong, wasn't I? So, you know, originally I'd said that, well, I'll get to that when I go down. But okay, next we have in 1989, Harlem Nights. And I remember during the making of this film, this is a movie that was directed by Eddie Murphy, and it quite possibly might have been the only film that Eddie Murphy directed. But I remember him talking about just, you know, how hard it was to direct and star in a movie. But I remember the making of this movie, I remember, you know, the behind the scenes information, I remember that we were going to get three generations of African American comics, all of which I loved. You know, Red Fox, who came before Richard Pryor. Red Fox, most certainly, if you've seen him in the show Sanford and Son, this is a guy that is so tremendously funny that it's just unbelievable. And, you know, speaking of Sanford and Son, it's just one of those shows, you know, that, you know, it's so hilarious. When I used to be down sometimes or be depressed about something, I would get into the habit of putting on something to watch that, you know, would kind of cheer my mood up. And no matter how down I was, if I could put on Sanford and Son, I was going to laugh because the show is just so much fun. And Red Fox is just a huge talent. Huge talent. This is the man that, you know, not a innovator in terms of stand-up or African-American humor, but most certainly he paved the way for so many comics that came ahead of him, and not just comics that were black. He paved the way for many comics. A genuine good person. I only have great things to say about Red Fox. But anyway, Red Fox was going to be in this movie, and I was just so fucking happy about that fact. Richard Pryor, you guys know my feelings about Richard Pryor. He was going to be in this movie. And then finally, Eddie Murphy. And it's no secret. I love Eddie Murphy. I think Eddie Murphy is a talent. But he suffered the same problem that Richard Pryor suffered from in his later career. He started doing all these family-friendly characters, and it ruined him. So when Harlem Nights was announced, I was really anticipating this film because I thought these are three of the ultimately best comics ever. This is going to be a great movie. And then I saw the movie, and it sucked ass. This movie sucked ass. This is one of the worst films with some of the worst humor that I've ever seen. And such a big disappointment, and even more fucking disappointment in the fact that you have three of the best comedians ever, and this calls for a drink. This fucking movie still stings my heart, man. Alright. Said enough about Harlem Nights. Okay. We've got... Now, this is a film that I said was Pryor's last film, but obviously I was mistaken because it looks like he's done three more things after this. Final film role. Yeah, this film came out in 1991, but his final film role was in 1997, and I've never heard of any of these after this film I'm about to mention. But this is a film released in 1991. I've never seen it. Actually stars Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor. And I remember seeing the trailers for this and just seeing, you know, Richard Pryor was suffering from multiple sclerosis, and it had really gotten the best of him by this time. And I remember seeing the trailers for this movie and Pryor just being so frail and so stiff when he moved and so honestly unfunny that I didn't want to see him that way. I couldn't stand to see him that way. So, you know, he was dealing with multiple sclerosis when he made See No Evil, Hear No Evil. But, you know, his disease enhanced his performance in being a blind guy, so it really wasn't as obvious as it was in Another You, which is the movie Another You, him and Gene Wilder again. And just from seeing the trailers, it hurt to see him in such bad shape. And I've never seen the film. I own it, but I have never watched the movie. And then, you know, later on I would hear people talk about how bad the movie was and how bad a shape Pryor was, and I just, you know, it's kind of one of those moments where your heart gets broken. And I couldn't stand to see him that way. And I resisted watching the film because, you know, Pryor is one of my big loves in life. And you don't like to see the things that you love hurt. And I still haven't watched the film yet. But Moving on, in 1991, we have the Three Musketeers. The Three Musketeers. And it says Pryor played the narrator, the wino, and the bartender. I have never heard of this. What is this? The Three Musketeers is a 1991 American comedy film directed by Romeo Foster Owens and written by and starring Flynn Blaine Pryor and the actor and screenwriter Carl Wilson. The film is loosely based on the 1844 novel The Three Musketeers. Pryor narrates the film and appears in two supporting roles. He received star billing for the film, making it the last theatrical film for which he received star billing in a dramatic role. Never heard of this film. The Three Musketeers. Really doesn't say much about it. Doesn't even list the money it made or how much it cost to make it. Who put this out? Paramount Pictures. What? Why have I never heard of this? The Three Musketeers. Was it successful? 4.3 out of 10. It doesn't sound like it. Richard Pryor stars in this parody of the Three Musketeers following a co-ed who falls asleep while reading the book and dreams about a trio of swashbuckling heroes. Okay. Interesting. Three Musketeers. Now, I'm just kind of curious, guys, to see if this is on Amazon. It's one of those films I'll have to add to the collection. Three Musketeers. Well, it's on Prime Video. Yeah, it's also on DVD. Only $6.98, and it also is on Prime Video, and it's free to watch, so I might give it a watch one day. No, I don't want you to start, because I'll get a copyright notice if the sound's being played, by which I just got two copyright notices on my last two videos, which I disputed. Alrighty, moving on, and nearing the end of Pryor's career. That was 1991, The Three Musketeers, and 1996, it would be 5 years before Pryor would do anything else, and the film is entitled Mad Dog Time. Never heard of this one either. Mad Dog Time, this is a Bruin Grip Services, that's the name of the studio, never heard of them. Cost $8 million to make and only grossed $107,000. Ouch. Let's see. Richard Pryor appeared as Jimmy the Grave Digger. And it sounds like basically it was a cameo. Main stars are Jeff Goldblum, Richard Dreyfuss, Gabriel Byrne, Ellen Birkin, Diane Lane, Gregory Hines, Kyle MacLachlan, MacLachlan, Burt Reynolds, had a lot of big stars in it. Wow. Sounds interesting. This film is notable for the various cameo appearances, including the first and final film appearance by Christopher Jones. That's an ensemble crime comedy film, which I, like I said, never heard of this movie. And finally, the final film in Richard Pryor's career, his final appearance, is in 1997 in a film called Lost Highway. And if Pryor had been in great health, wouldn't you know that he'd still be making movies? I think America had just accepted Pryor as the man who made us laugh. And he could do no wrong in film. People just loved Richard Pryor. But 1987 or 1997, The Lost Highway, or just Lost Highway. I've never seen this film. I've heard of it, but I've never seen it. Stars Bill Pullman, Patricia Arquette, Robert Blake, Gary Busey, and it was not a hit. $3.8 million at the box office. But Pryor, where is Pryor? Richard Pryor played a character named Arnie. I think I've even seen this film in the bargain bin, but I just never picked it up. But now I'll have to pick it up just to see Pryor's appearance in the movie. But anyway, guys, there we have the films of Richard Pryor. Many of these films I do have, many I don't have. But I will most definitely have to give it a watch and review some of these movies. Wow. Just looking over some information on Richard Pryor, it said in 1977, after many years of heavy smoking and drinking, Pryor suffered a mild heart attack at age 37. I never knew that. I never knew that he had a mild heart attack. He recovered and resumed performing in January. The attack was in November. 1986, he was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. 1990, Pryor suffered a second heart attack while in Australia. He underwent triple bypass surgery in 1991. In late 2004, his sister said that he had lost his voice as a result of his multiple sclerosis. However, on January 9, 2005, Pryor's wife rebutted this statement in a post on Pryor's official website, citing Richard as saying, "I'm sick of hearing this shit about me not talking. Not true. I have good days and bad days, but I still am a talking motherfucker." Yeah, I think I kind of believe Pryor on this. Gotta believe him. Sounds just like him. On December 10th, 2005, 9 days after his 65th birthday, Pryor suffered a third heart attack in Los Angeles. He was taken to a local hospital after his wife's attempts to resuscitate him failed. He was pronounced dead at 7:58 a.m. His widow, Jennifer, was quoted as saying, "At the end, there was a smile on his face. He was cremated and his ashes were given to the family." His ashes were later spread in 2019 by his wife, widow, Jennifer, in Hana, Hawaii. Forensic pathologists believe Pryor's fatal heart attack was caused by coronary artery disease that was at least partially brought on by his years of tobacco use. And then America lost a legendary comedian. The world lost a legendary comedian. Richard Pryor, never, never, ever be forgotten. And I can most certainly say that he's brought me a lot of laughs, a lot of entertainment over the years, and I'll always have a fondness for him in my heart. He'll always be in my heart. So rest in peace, Richard Pryor. You are missed. I missed you. And those of us who love you around the world miss you. Thanks for watching, everybody.